Any smoker who has ever tried to quit smoking will tell you all about the sweet cravings they experience after giving up cigarettes and other tobacco products. These cravings for sweet foods are in fact the reason why many former smokers go on to gain significant amounts of weight. According to several studies, sugar intake significantly reduces nicotine cravings and can even ease some of the symptoms of nicotine withdrawal that smokers experience when trying to quit. However, nicotine is hardly the only drug that has this interesting dynamic with sugar. Recovering heroin addicts, for example, frequently report intense sugar cravings. Furthermore, there is substantial research suggesting that binge eaters are at an elevated risk of developing drug addictions should they undergo gastric bypass surgery, in what scientists call a transfer addiction. But far from being a potential treatment for addiction, the research suggests that sugar is only able to interact in this way with addictive drugs because, well, sugar might actually be addictive in its own right. My name is Hesham and I'm a medical doctor and this is my YouTube channel where I make videos about the human brain with an emphasis on optimizing brain function and performance through science. If that's the kind of stuff that you'd like to see more of on YouTube, then subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified when I upload my next video next week. Our species has consumed sugar for as long as we've been around. We can see evidence of this in our primate cousins who show a clear preference for sugar-packed fruit. Sugar is rich in energy. It requires little to no digestion, and excess sugar can readily be stored in the body as fat. In short, metabolically speaking, sugar was and still is an instant hit. Historically, organisms that had a taste for sugar would have had a survival advantage, as they would have been able to consume more sweet foods during times of plenty, allowing them to store more energy in their bodies in preparation for times of scarcity.
And though Pooh's mind could easily be fooled, his mouth could not.
It's a really neat system. Eat all the sugar you can right now because you're unlikely to have any for the foreseeable future. Neat systems, however, only work as intended so long as the variables don't change, so long as sugar remains in short supply and our access to it is somewhat limited. Rats, like humans, have an appetite for both sugar and cocaine. In fact, some of the most compelling evidence we have about the addictiveness of sugar comes from experiments performed on lab rats. When given a choice between sugar and cocaine, rats will almost always choose sugar over cocaine. Remarkably, their choices remained the same even when the value of the cocaine reward was increased up to the near convulsive dose of 1.5 milligrams, suggesting that the reward value of sugar is inherently higher than the maximum possible reward value of cocaine. One study even went as far as to use rats that were already addicted to cocaine. These were rats that had had free access to cocaine for extended periods of time and had begun showing behaviors typical of addiction. Surprisingly, 95% of these addicted rats still chose sugar over cocaine. In fact, these rats still chose sugar even when the sugar was replaced with an artificial sweetener, saccharin, that had no nutritional or calorific value whatsoever. Rats, much like humans, appear to be hooked onto sweetness. In most mammals, including rats and humans, the taste for sweet foods is unique in that it is deeply tied to the brain's reward system. Humans can detect sweet, sour, salty, bitter, and savory tastes. It's only sweet food, however, that activates the very same regions in the brain that are also activated by cocaine, resulting in a significant increase in dopamine as shown by these now infamous MRI scans of the brain's activity. Crucially, this spike in dopamine takes place before the sugar is consumed. In other words, dopamine levels are highest during cravings and anticipation, and lower during actual consumption, meaning that our brains are hardwired to want sugar more than they actually enjoy eating it. Some would call that a recipe for addiction. But sugar does not only behave similarly to cocaine in its activation of dopamine receptors. That's because sugar also behaves similarly to heroin and other opioids in that it binds to mu opioid receptors. In fact, sugar is such an effective analgesic that it's routinely used in the form of an oral glucose or sucrose solution to relieve pain in newborns. Its analgesic effect typically lasts for around 5 to 8 minutes. When talking about sugar addiction and the sweetening of the world's diet, it feels wrong not to mention the parallels between the histories of sugar and cocaine. That's because long before it was the dangerous and addictive drug that we know today, cocaine was a relatively mild and harmless stimulant found in cocoa leaves at concentrations of around 0.5 to 1%. For around 8,000 years, these cocoa leaves were enjoyed by civilizations in the Andes in modern-day South America. The people of these regions consumed the unprocessed leaves by either chewing them or brewing them into a tea. Not only were the leaves high in iron, vitamin B, and vitamin C, but they proved effective at increasing energy and stamina, and were also used to induce muscle relaxation, thereby relieving menstrual cramps. In an era before modern-day pharmaceuticals, cocoa leaves could also be counted upon for their analgesic and antibacterial properties. Furthermore, they also help to treat altitude sickness and prevent constipation. No wonder the Inca developed such an appetite for those leaves. The trouble only started, it seems, in 1860, when cocaine was isolated and then later purified into the crystalline powdered form we know today. The reason I'm telling you all this is because for the longest time, sugar too was fairly harmless to us humans. It was only when we began purifying, processing, and adding it to all our food that we began to see the obesity epidemic take form. And we began to see discussions about sugar addiction pop up both in the media and the scientific literature. While the question of sugar addiction remains a controversial one, even among scientists, I think both proponents and opponents of sugar addiction can agree on at least one thing. Biologically speaking, sugar addiction should have never been a problem for us humans. It only turned into one because availability, dose, and potency are everything, which perhaps means we should worry less about whether sugar is addictive or whether it's more addictive than cocaine, and instead worry more about us adding sugar into tomato and toothpaste for no good reason. If you enjoyed this video, then give this video a like, please, and subscribe if you have not done so already.